गोपी जन वल्लभा गिरिवरदारे यशोदानंदन व्रज जन रंजन यमुनतीरावनचारी जय राधा माधवा कुंज बिहारी जय राधा माधवा कुंज बिहारी जय ओम विष्णुपाद परमहंस परिव्राजकाचार्य श्री हिज डिवाइन ग्रेस एसी भक्ति वेदांत स्वामी श्रील प्रभुपाद की जय। जय ओम विष्णुपाद परमहंस परिव्राजकाचार्य श्री हिज डिवाइन ग्रेस भक्ति सिद्धांत सरस्वती ठाकुर श्रील प्रभुपाद की जय। नामाचार्य श्रील हरिदास ठाकुर की जय। ग्रंथराज श्रीमद भागवतम की जय। अनंत कोटि वैष्णव वृंद की जय। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयमुदीरयेत्। नष्टप्रायेष्व भद्रेषु नित्यं भागवत सेवया भगवतीर्वुत्तम श्लोके भक्तिर्भवती नैष्टिकी। कृष्णाय वासुदेवाय देवकी नंदनाय च नंदगोपकुमाराय गोविंदाय नमो नमः। Reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 11, Chapter 31, entitled The Disappearance of Lord Shri Krishna. Text number 12. Martyena yo guru sutam yamalokanitam. Tvam chana yat charanada. परमास्त्र दग्धम् जिज्ञेन्त कांतकमपि शमसावनीश किं स्वावने स्वरयणन् स्वरणयन् मृगयुं सदेहम् मर्त्येन यो गुरुसुतं यमलोकनीतं त्वां चाणयच्चरणद परमास्त्रदग्धम् जिज्ञेन्त कांतकमपि शमसावनीश किं स्वावने स्वरणयन् मृगयुं स्वदेहम् मर्त्येन यो गुरुसुतं यमलोकनीतम् त्वां चाण यच्चरणदपरमास्त्रदग्धम् जिज्ञेन्तकान्तकमपीशमसावणीश किं स्वावणे स्वर्णयन्मृगयुं स्वदेहम् मर्त्येन यो गुरुसुतं यमलोकनीतम् मर्त्येन यो गुरुसुतं यमलोकनीतम् त्वां चाण यच्चरणद परमास्त्रदग्धम् जिज्ञेन्तकान्तकमणीशमसावणीश मर्त्येन यो गुरुसुतं यमलोकनीतम् त्वां चाण यच्चरणद परमास्त्रदग्धम् जिज्ञेन्तकान्तकमपीशमसावणीश किं स्वावणे स्वर्णयन् मृगयुं स्वदेहम् वर्ड टू वर्ड ट्रांसलेशन मर्त्येन इन द सेम ह्यूमन बॉडी यह हु गुरु सुतम द सन ऑफ ए स्पिरिचुअल मास्टर यमलोक नीतम टू द प्लैनेट ऑफ यमराज Maharaj, Neetam brought Tvam, you, Cha, and Anayat brought back Sharanada, the giver of shelter, Parama Astra, by the supreme weapon, the Brahmastra, Dagdam burned, Jigye, He conquered Antaka of the agents of death. Antakam, who is the death? Api, even Isham, Lord Shiva, Asau, he, Krishna, Anish, incapable, Kim, whether Sva, of himself, avane, in the protection, swaha, to the spiritual world, anayat, brought, மிருகயும் த ஹண்டர் சதேகம் இன் த சேம் பாடி. Translation and purport by the disciples of His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Translation: Lord Krishna brought the son of His Guru back from the planet of the Lord of Death in the boy's self-same body. And as the ultimate giver of protection, He saved you also when you were burned by the Brahmastra of Ashwatthama. He conquered in battle even Lord Shiva, who deals death to the agents of death. And He sent the hunter Jara directly to Vaikuntha in His human body. How could such a personality be unable to protect his own self? Purport: To mitigate his own and Parishit Maharaj's distress at the narration of Lord Krishna's departure from this world, Sri Shukadeva Goswami here gives several clear examples proving that Lord Krishna is far beyond the influence of death. Although the son of Lord Krishna's spiritual master had been taken by death, the Lord brought him back in his same body. Similarly, the power of Brahman cannot touch, the power of a Brahmana cannot touch Lord Krishna, since Parishit Maharaj, though burned by the Brahmastra weapon, was easily saved by the Lord. Lord Shiva was clearly defeated by Lord Krishna in the battle with Banasur, and the hunter Jara was sent to a Vaikuntha planet in his same human body. Death is an insignificant expansion of Lord Krishna's external potency and cannot possibly act upon the Lord himself. Those who actually understand the transcendental nature of Lord Krishna's activities will find convincing evidence in these examples. Omagyanatimirandasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshuron Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Namavom Vishnupadaya Krishna Preshtaya Bhutale Srimate Bhaktivedanta Swami Nitinamine Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvisesha Shunyavadi Pashyati Deshadarine Jayasri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Srivasadi Gaurabhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Ram 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 Hare Hare. So we are in the end of the 11th canto, last chapter. The disappearance pastimes of the Krishna and the disappearance pastimes of Yadu dynasty are being described in the last two chapters. In fact, the whole 11th canto is leading to these disappearance pastimes, because right from the first chapter of the 11th canto, where the curse upon the Yadu dynasty was described by Shukadeva Goswami, and then the Uddhava Gita, and then the disappearance pastimes are described in the end of the 11th canto. Generally, in the case of a Vaishnava, the disappearance day of a Vaishnava is celebrated once and more joyously than the appearance day of a Vaishnava, because on the disappearance day of a Vaishnava Acharya, the Vaishnava has left with the left us with the different remembrance of his different activities and contributions, because on the appearance day of a Vaishnava, we are not aware of the qualities and the contribution which is going to make. Disappearance day, or also disappearance day of a Vaishnava, is a joyous in the sense that he has actually joined in Krishna's eternal leela in that sense. But in the case of Krishna, we don't observe the disappearance day of Krishna because that is a painful for a devotee. The appearance day is celebrated. But nevertheless, in this disappearance pastimes, there are, because the Vaishnava Acharyas have actually have given different elaborate purports and different lessons and Siddhanta. So following the footsteps of the Vaishnava Acharyas, those many devotees have actually described in the past 1 month or so. So I'll repeat some of the points, I'll share some of the points what Jiva Goswami has given in the Krishna Sandarbha. So we see in the disappearance pastimes, the last chapter described the annihilation of the Yadu dynasty. And in this chapter, we also see the disappearance of Krishna. So I'll just go through some of the verses. So in the last chapter, at the end of the last chapter, Krishna was speaking to Dwaraka. Krishna said to Dwaraka, Tvam tu maddharmam astaya jnana nishta upekshakaha manmaya rachita metam vijnayo pashamam vraja. This is the 49th verse of the previous chapter. Tvam tu, that means as for yourself, that means like others may have a different opinion, but as for yourself, what I expect that you should actually, how I want you to actually understand these events. As for yourself, tvam tu maddharmam astaya, you be situated in my dharma. Maddharmam astaya. So what is the meaning of the word maddharmam here? Maddharmam means maddharmam mama sva bhakti paripala yitrutva rupam sva tulya parikara sangitva rupam. So you be situated in my dharma, that means Krishna is telling to Dwaraka that you have faith or trust in my essential nature of protecting and nourishing my devotees and also of remaining in the company of my associates who are my equals. So Krishna is saying that sva bhakta pratipala itritva rupam, you have trust in my dharma, you have trust in my nature of protecting my devotees. Sva bhakta paripala itritva rupam. And sva tulya parikara sangitva rupam, you also have a trust in my nature that how I always remain with my devotees whom I consider as my equals. Because Krishna in the Vaikuntha planets, even in the Vaikuntha planets, when a person gets the four types of personal liberation, Krishna makes them as his equal by giving them the same opulences as himself, or by giving the Vaikuntha resident as the same form as himself, four-handed form. He allows them to stay in the same place as himself, Samipya, Salokya, Sarupya and Sarshti. So sva tulya parikara sangitva rupam means like you be situated, you have trust in my nature of sva bhakta paripala itritva rupam sva tulya parikara sangitva rupam and maddharma mastaya jnana nishta upekshakaha. Jnana nishta, you become fixed in my this knowledge, you become fixed in the knowledge. And manmaya rachitam etam. So the word etam is used to actually indicate the events which have just happened right in front of your eyes. So that means Krishna is referring to the the annihilation of the Edo dynasty, which just happened in front of the Dwarukas' eyes. So, man maya rachitam yetam. Understand that these events which have just happened, they are man maya rachitam. They are actually nothing but they are the creation of my maya. Or Jiva Goswami says that, mama mayaya eva indra jalavad rachitam. So indra jala refers to a magic. They are just creation, they are like a magic show, or they are just creation of my maya. Man maya rachitam etam vijnayo upashamam vraja. So after understanding in this way, you become upekshaka and upashamam. Upekshaka, you become indifferent. Become indifferent to the bereavement resulting from the superficial perception of what has happened. Vijnayo upekshako bahirdrishtya. Bahirdrishtya means become indifferent to the superficial perception of whatever has happened. Vijnayo upekshako bahirdrishtya jatam shokam upekshamana upashamam chittakshobam nivrittim vraja prapnuhi. Become indifferent to the bereavement of the superficial understanding of whatever has happened, and then upashamam, that means be situated in peace and thus attain peace, or in other words, that don't be unnecessarily mentally disturbed. Attain freedom from mental disturbance. So in this way, Krishna is actually, these are the direct words spoken by Krishna to Dwaruka. Jiva Goswami also gives few additional examples. He says that when it is mentioned that man maya rachita metam, so whatever has just happened, it is just a creation of my maya. So in the Kurma Puran, there is a section called as Vyasa Gita. In that particular section, Sad Achara, good conduct, is described. And especially in the conduct of a good conduct of a chaste wife, there is in the, it is mentioned that how Ravana kidnapped only the Maya Sita, and the real Sita was actually taken by Agni Dev, and Agni was actually protecting the real Sita. Ravana could kidnap only the Maya Sita. In fact, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, when he went to Rameshwaram, he saw the Brahmanas were actually chanting this particular portion of the Kurma Puran. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu told them to copy that portion of the Kurma Puran, and he brought that original manuscript of the Kurma Puran in order to pacify the Brahmana whom he met in the Madurai, who was actually in great sorrow when he heard that Sita was kidnapped by Ravana. So Jiva Goswami is quoting this incident. He says that just like Ravana kidnapped only the illusory Sita, so similarly, that man maya rachitam, this annihilation of the Edo dynasty, was a creation of the illusory potency of Krishna. And another example which is given of illusory leela is that the departure of the Pandavas after the disappearance of Krishna, the Pandavas and Draupadi, they started walking towards the northern direction. And one by one, first Draupadi fell down. Draupadi collapsed. The Pandavas did not turn back. And then Nakul collapsed. And then Sakadev collapsed. And then Arjuna collapsed. And then Bhima collapsed. But the Yudhishthira Maharaj kept on walking. But there was a dog which was following behind Yudhishthira Maharaj. And at a particular point of time, Indra came and told Yudhishthira Maharaj that please come to heaven. And then Yudhishthira said that I will come to heaven. Indra told that your brothers and Draupadi, they have already arrived in heaven. and I have come to take you to heaven. So then Yudhishthira Maharaj said that I will come to heaven provided you can allow this dog also to come along with me to heaven. Because this dog has also come all the way along with me. So I don't want to leave this dog behind. But Indra said, why do you want to remain, like when your other brothers actually fell down, you did not actually, you did not turn back. But why are you insisting that this dog also should come along with you? And Yudhishthir said, but Yudhishthir insisted, but this dog has come along with me. I want the dog also to be taken along with me to the heaven. So at that time, when Yudhishthir insisted, so at that time, the dog actually transformed himself in the form of the Dharma. Dharma personified. And Dharma said that actually, I was trying to test you. I was trying to test your nature. And then the dog transformed into Dharma. Then Indra actually took Yudhishthira Maharaj to heaven. When Yudhishthira Maharaj went to heaven, he saw Duryodhan in the heaven, but he couldn't see the Pandavas and Draupadi. And he asked Indra that, you told that my brothers and Draupadi are there. Yeah, I want to go to the place where my brothers and Draupadi are there. Can you take me to that place? And then one Devaduta, one messenger of the Indra, like started taking Yudhishthira to one particular place. And then when the Devaduta was taking Yudhishthira Maharaj, so that particular way itself, path itself was very dark. It was actually filled with mosquitoes and it was filled with some human skulls and it was a very dark path and a very dangerous path. And Yudhishthira could understand that he is actually taking me to hell. And then he asked that, how long I have to walk? Because I am very tired. And then the Devaduta said that, no, if you want, you can go back. You can actually go back in the same path. Like that he told Yudhishthir. And Yudhishthir, when he was about to turn back, that time some people started actually crying. Some people started actually crying that, oh please, oh Yudhishthir, please do not leave us. Because of your presence, because of your presence, we have got some relief from the suffering. Please do not abandon us and please do not go back. On that time, Yudhishthira asked like, can you please tell me like, who are you who are actually making this appeal? Then they said, we are your brothers and Draupadi, like that they called, they said. Then Yudhishthira told the Devaduta, that you go and tell Indra that I am not going to come back. I want to stay with my brothers and Draupadi. So although Yudhishthira understood, although they are actually in the hell, then Yudhishthira felt that I want to stay with my brothers and Draupadi instead of my individual comfort of staying in the heaven. So at that time, when Yudhishthira Maharaj made that statement, so at that time the Indra and the other devatas appeared. And then the hellish atmosphere got transformed into a heavenly atmosphere. So this is also another example which is given of an illusory Leela. So this was another test of Yudhishthira Maharaj, the last test of Yudhishthira Maharaj. So these are two examples of an illusory Leela, Ravana kidnapping Sita, and then the Pandavas apparently experiencing the hell. So in this the present verse, so Jiva Goswami says about this Maushal Leela. The reason for this Maushal Leela was that one of the reason is that Brahma Shapa A Nivartyata. Krishna wanted to show that how the curse of the Brahmanas cannot be reversed. How the words of the sages who had cursed Samba and others, Krishna wanted to make those words become true, how they cannot be reversed. He wanted to show the importance of the words of the Brahmanas or the Vaishnava Parad. He wanted to drive this lesson. And at the same time, another reason is that Krishna, by this Leela, he provided justification for those people of atheistic temperament who want to actually deny the godhood of Krishna. So actually, like, Krishna is the foundation of everything. Aham sarvasya prabhavo matta sarvam pravartate. He is the foundation of everything. But when we say he is the foundation of everything, he is the foundation, he is the support of everything, including even for those people who oppose him. Including those people who have an atheistic temperament, who actually oppose his supremacy. So for this, for their sake, Krishna conducts his pastimes in such a way that their convictions can be maintained. So therefore he performed this Maushal Leela in order to give support to their actually ideologies, in order to give support to their atheistic temperament, and for, of course, for the Kali Yuga to actually begin. And also we see, of course, it will be discussed in the next verse, but Krishna performed this Leela in order to teach people how that the body is temporary and the material world is temporary. That by showing that how even great people also have to die. And therefore Krishna wanted to, through this particular Leela, he wanted to actually inspire a spirit of Vairagya by indicating the temporary nature of the material world. And coming to this verse, Martyenayo Guru Sutam Yamaloka Neetam. So here, Martyenayo Guru Sutam Yamaloka Neetam, Shukdev Goswami is speaking this verse in order to actually mitigate the distress while narrating Krishna's departure from this world. In order to mitigate his own distress and to mitigate the distress of Parikshit Maharaj by speaking about the extraordinary activities of Krishna in this particular verse. So normally, like when there is a tape recorder, suppose the tape recorder, some lecture is being played. The tape recorder does not get affected by what is being spoken through it. Or when the tape recorder is actually recording a particular lecture, the tape recorder is not affected by the whatever the subject matter is being spoken. The tape recorder does not have any feeling. It's not, does not get affected by this one. But in the case of Shukdev Goswami or Parikshit Maharaj, Shukdev Goswami gets affected by the narration of the Krishna's disappearance Leela. And Parikshit Maharaj also gets affected by the disappearance Leela. So in order to mitigate his own distress and the mitigate the distress of Parikshit Maharaj, so Shukdev Goswami is recollecting four extraordinary activities performed by Krishna in this particular verse. So therefore, like when we hear or when we speak Srimad Bhagavatam, one should try to get affected by the subject matter of the Srimad Bhagavatam. Otherwise, our speaking or hearing of the Srimad Bhagavatam may be more like a tape recorder, which does not get affected by the subject matter of the which is being spoken or recorded by the tape recorder. So here, he mentions four actually activities. So Krishna, when after he studied in the ashram of Sandipani Muni asked for a Guru Dakshina, knowing the position of Krishna, he asked that, please get back my dead son. And Krishna went to the ocean because his son disappeared in the ocean. He asked the ocean guard. Ocean guard said that Sandipani Muni's son was actually killed by a demon called as Panchajana. And Krishna killed the demon, but he couldn't find the Sandipani Muni's son within the belly of Panchajana. And then Krishna went to hellish planets and he blew the conch shell there. When he blew the conch shell in the outskirts of the hellish planets, all the people in the hellish planets, they got delivered by hearing Krishna's conch shell. And then he told Yamaraj, I have come to actually take back the son of my spiritual master. And Yamaraj gave back the son of Sandipani Muni. And Krishna brought that son of Sandipani Muni from the hellish planets. So then, but one may get the question, Parishit Maharaj may be thinking that if Krishna could bring back the dead son of his guru, he could certainly protect his own associates from the jaws of death. So that is the point which Shukdev Goswami is trying to draw. If Krishna can bring back the dead son from the hellish planet, so why can't he protect the Yadus? But then, one can still give a counter reply by saying that, but in the case of the Yadus, they were cursed by the Brahmanas, and the curse pronounced by the Brahmanas was of a superior force. In the case of Sandipani Muni's son did not die by the curse of a Brahmana. He was just killed by a demon and he went to hell. But the curse by the Brahmana is of a much superior force. So maybe Krishna could actually bring back the son of Sandipani Muni, but he cannot. But the Brahmana's curse is actually superior compared to even to Krishna's power. So one may still give that this counter argument. So therefore, Shukdev Goswami gives a next example by saying that Tvam Chanayat Sharanada Paramastra Dagdam. That Krishna, like he's saying that you were burnt by the Paramastra. Paramastra here refers to the Brahmastra. You are burnt by the power of weapon of Brahma, and Brahma is the greatest of all the Brahmanas. Brahma is the first Brahmana in the universe. So that Paramastra, there is the weapon of Brahma, and you are already burnt by that weapon and released by another Brahmana, Ashwatthama. So Krishna protected you from both these Brahmanas, Ashwatthama, who is actually Brahma Bandhu, but also from the Lord Brahma's weapon. So therefore, Krishna's power is superior even to the curse of the Brahmanas. And then the third example he gives, that when Aniruddha was actually, in the episode of Aniruddha, when Banasura actually kept Aniruddha as a captive, Krishna went to attack the Banasur. That time, Lord Shiva fought on the side of Banasur against Krishna. And Krishna actually defeated Lord Shiva in that battle. And what is the position of Lord Shiva? Lord Shiva, he gives death punishment even to the Yamaraj at the time of Pralaya. At the time of the annihilation of the universe, Lord Shiva gives death punishment even to Yamaraj, and Krishna defeated that Lord Shiva. So therefore, if Krishna can defeat that Lord Shiva who gives death punishment to Yamaraj, how can Krishna fail to protect the Yadavas who are his own devotees? Therefore, the mood of this particular verse is that don't think that Krishna was unable to protect the Yadavas. And the same point which he mentioned, that Svabhakta Paripala Itritva Rupam, that is Krishna's essential nature, because Kaunteya Pratijanihi Name Bhakta Pranashyati, if Krishna can defeat Lord Shiva, then why could he not protect the Yadavas? And then the fourth example he gives is that Krishna sent the hunter Jara, who shot arrow at his feet, mistaking his feet to be the mouth of a deer. Krishna sent that hunter Jara to Vaikuntha. The word, actually the word used is Swar. Swar means Swarga. But another meaning of the word is Swar, it also refers to Vaikuntha. Even if you read the Amarkosh dictionary, Swar refers to Vaikuntha. So Krishna sent Jara to Vaikuntha. So therefore, these four examples clearly clearly mentioned the extraordinary activity of Krishna, which he performed in actually protecting his devotees. So therefore, Krishna told Daruka that mad dharma mastaya, be situated in my dharma, that have faith that how I actually always protect my devotees. Swa bhakta paripala itritva rupam. And then, in regards to the previous verse also, few points I'll just mention. The previous verse, Rajan Parasya Tanubruj. Sukadeva Goswami told that, O King, Parasya Tanubrut, the activities of the appearance and disappearance, Rajan Parasya Tanubruj, Jananya Apya Yeha. The activities of the appearance and disappearance of the Tanubrut means the embodied associates of the Parasya. Parasya refers to the Supreme Absolute Truth or Krishna. So Jananya Apya Yeha, the activities of the appearance and disappearance of the embodied associates of the Absolute Truth are Maya Vidambanam Avehi Yata Natasya, are nothing but the play of the Supreme Lord's Maya. And Yata Natasya, like that of an actor. Like that of an actor in a dramatic performance. And Srishtva Atmane Idam Anuvishya Vihritya. Srishtva, having created this world, and Srishtva Atmana, having brought forth this creation by himself, Srishtva Atmana, Idam, this universe, and then Anuvishya, and having pervaded this universe, as the super soul within the universe, and Viharatya, having sported in it, having performed different pastimes, Viharatya, having performed different pastimes within it, having played within it, and Ante Samhritya, and having finally dissolved this universe, Atma Mahima Uparatasa Aste, Uparata, having done all these things, he remains indifferent to it. Being withdrawn into his own glory, Atma Mahima, being situated in his own glory. So, here also we see Tanubrut, Parasya Tanubrut. So, Parasya Tanubrut, it refers to how the bodies of the Yadus, the embodied bodies of the Yadus, embodied bodies, the appearance and disappearance of the embodied associates of the absolute transcendence, or the supreme absolute truth. That means the bodies of the Yadus, they are completely spiritual in nature. Parasya Tanubrut means the Yadus actually belong to Krishna. So just like Krishna's body is transcendental, the Yadus' bodies are also transcendental, because they are the eternal associates of Krishna. So Jiva Goswami quotes a verse from the first canto, sixth chapter, when Narada was narrating his story. So Narada Muni tells, he quotes this verse that Prayujyamane Mayitam Shuddham Bhagavatim Tanum. So the word Bhagavatim Tanum means that he obtained a body, given by the Supreme Lord, Bhagavatim Tanum, which belongs to the transcendence. So similarly, Yadu's body, this Parasya Tanubrut, it has a similarity with the Bhagavatim Tanum. So therefore, Yadu's bodies are also transcendental. So therefore, but the disappearance of Yadu dynasty is a Maya Vidambana. It is a creation of illusory potency. And then he also gives the explanation for Balram's disappearance. Because it is described that when Balramji sat in meditation after the annihilation of Yadu dynasty, a snake emanated from Balramji's mouth, and then the snake actually entered into the ocean. And Balramji also disappeared. And in order to show that, so at that time a big white snake emerged from his mouth and entered into the sea. And Balramji also disappeared in a bewildering way. But that description should not be taken to mean that Balramji died. Because in the beginning of Krishna's appearance, the various actually avatars entered into Krishna's body. So similarly, when Balramji appeared, the Ananta Sesha, who is an expansion of Balramji, also entered into Balramji's body. And at the time of the disappearance Leela, that Ananta Sesha, it separated himself from Balramji's body. That is what is being indicated. And elsewhere in the Bhagavatam, for example, in the Narayana Kavacha section, in the sixth canto, in the Narayana Kavacha section, it is described that Balramji is possessed to be, Balramji is affirmed as possessing power superior to that of Shesha. And Balramji is mentioned as being the eternal protector of his worshippers. So therefore, even Balramji's disappearance is also creation of the Maya. And then when it comes to Krishna, and also one more reference is given, when Jarasandha was actually fighting with Krishna and Balram, Jarasandha was a great warrior, but when he saw Balramji, although Balramji was a very young boy at that time, but Jarasandha was a greatest warrior at that time, but still when Jarasandha spoke to Balram, Jarasandha said that either you go to heaven after being killed by me, or kill me. Or kill me, like that he said. That means like Jarasandha got the thought, although Balramji was young and he was very superior, but Jarasandha could get the thought that, oh, this Balramji has the ability to kill me. So that is the words of Jarasandha also. So Jiva Goswami quotes that verse also to show that how Balramji is actually, because Jarasandha also could get an intuition, oh, Balramji is an eternal person, he cannot be killed. So therefore, Saraswati entered his mouth and spoke that word that, you kill me. So that means even, he is trying to indicate that even Jarasandha got an intuition that Balramji is an eternal person. So he is giving these verses to show that the eternal nature of Balramji. And also in regards to Krishna's disappearance, I think few verses before in this chapter, it was described that the sixth verse of this chapter, it was mentioned, Yoga Dharanaya Dagdva Lokantaram Lokabhiramam Svatanum Dharana Dhyana Mangalam Yoga Dharanaya Agneya Dagdva Dama Vishat Svakam. So Krishna actually, in fact, when Krishna, he went into a yogic meditation and he closed his eyes. Even when he closed his eyes, by that also he is teaching different lessons. By one lesson is that he is teaching that at the time of the death, one should actually think about the Supreme Lord. Antakale cha mameva smaran muktva kalevaram. So by closing his eyes, he is teaching to every living entity that one should actually meditate on the Supreme Lord at the time of the death. And also he is teaching that he closed his eyes because many of the demigods, they wanted to actually invite Krishna to their abodes. That while going back to the spiritual world, just pay a visit to our houses, our abodes on the way. So Krishna wanted to avoid the social obligations. So in the last stage of life, like one is supposed to avoid the different social obligations or social functions. So Krishna wanted to avoid that. Therefore, he didn't want to give a chance for them to make some request like that. Therefore, he closed his eyes. And also another reason why he closed his eyes was that because all these demigods are like the mystic expansions of Krishna. So they are like the different mystic siddhis and mystic expansions of Krishna. Krishna is teaching to the yogis how the yogis should not become attached to their mystic siddhis at the time of their departure from this world. So that is why even in the 15th chapter, when Krishna spoke about the different mystic siddhis, he said all these mystic siddhis are an obstacle for a person in his advancement to go to the spiritual world, because these mystic siddhis can actually can give a sense of control, and then it may, can make a person attached to some name and fame, etc. That's why Rishabhadev also rejected the mystic siddhis. So Krishna, by closing his eyes, he is teaching that how one should not become attached to the different mystic siddhis. But the verse says that Agneya Dagdva. Dagdva means burning his body. So generally the yogis, when they perform the yogic meditation, they generate a fire from that yogic meditation, and then through that fire they burn their bodies. Like Sati, when she saw that Lord Shiva is being disrespected in that sacrifice of Daksha, she generated a fire from her body and then she burnt her body. So, but in the case of Krishna, the verse seems to be saying that Agneya Dagdva, he burnt his body. But then, like in the current verse which we are discussing, it shows that if Krishna can bring a person from the hellish planets, and Krishna can revive Parishit Maharaj, who was burnt by the Brahmastra, how can Krishna burn his body? So therefore, that verse should be taken as, because in Sanskrit language is so versatile, that by the different sandhi rules, the joining of the words, it can be Agneya Dagdva, or it can be taken as Agneya Adagdva. Adagdva means which cannot be burnt. So that means, so then that verse becomes like Krishna actually performed the, by his yogic meditation, Krishna kept his own body without being burnt. And then he departed for this abode. So like that, when we, Jiva Goswami says that whenever we find the verses which describe the disappearance of the Lord or his associates, you will find certain words in those verses which can give two meanings. One meaning in order to support the atheistic conclusions of the conclusions of the atheistic people, and another meaning which actually gives light, which gives indication of the transcendental nature of the Lord's body and his pastimes. Few more points regarding to the Yadu dynasty disappearance. The third canto purport, the third canto, when Uddhava is narrating that, Uddhava says that Atate tad anugyata buktva pitva cha varunim taya vibramshita jnana duruktair marma pasprashuhu. So Uddhava says that, so all these Yadavas, tad anugyata, after being permitted, tad anugyata, after being permitted by Krishna and the Brahmanas, all these Yadavas took that maireya drink, that liquor. And then by drinking that, they became actually delirious and they got intoxicated, and then they spoke such harsh words which actually pierce the core of the hearts of each other. duruktair marma paspurashuhu, which touched the cores of each other's hearts with the harsh words. And then, so in this connection, Prabhupada mentions, he gives a lesson on a human perspective about the danger of intoxication. Actually, the Yadus are highly cultured people. They give great respect to the Brahmanas. But the power of intoxication is such that even such highly refined, cultured, sensitive people, even they can become contaminated by intoxication, even they can forget themselves in that state of intoxication, and they can actually speak such harsh words, and which actually led to the quarrel and they killed each other. So this event also shows the power of intoxication. Just like the gambling match, it shows the power of gambling, how the Dharma personified Yudhishthira Maharaj, that with the personification of Dharma, who told in the marriage of Draupadi, he said that in my mind, nothing adharmic can ever come in my mind. So, all of us should get married to Draupadi, because in my mind, nothing adharmic can come in my mind. So that was the confidence of Yudhishthira Maharaj. So that personality, even he got actually affected by the atmosphere of gambling, that he actually described about the beauty of Draupadi in the open assembly, and then he put Draupadi as a stake. So therefore, just like the Mahabharata gambling match describes about the power of gambling, that it can actually affect the mind of Dharma personified. So similarly, intoxication can actually contaminate the minds of such highly cultured people, the Yadus. So Prabhupada is giving this lesson to all of us on a human perspective. At the same time, in the very next verse, Prabhupada gives another lesson from a divine perspective. So he says that he comments on the word Tad Anugyata. Tad Anugyata means the Yadus actually took that intoxication with the permission of Krishna, with the permission of the Brahmanas. That means the whole thing was actually, whole thing was the will of Krishna. So Prabhupada says that the Lord Krishna wanted the Yadus to be so destroyed, therefore the Yadus obeyed the order of Krishna as indicated by the word Tad Anugyata. So from the divine perspective, it was the will of Krishna, Yadus acted like that. So in the case of the Prachetas, they, by exhibiting their mutual friendship with each other, they showed their obedience to Krishna while performing austerities under the water for 10,000 years. They showed their obedience to Krishna by their mutual friendship with each other. And Yadavas showed their obedience to Krishna by fighting and killing each other. But the common point is that the principle of obedience or Sharanagati to the will of Krishna. So both these pastimes teach that common point. And yeah, so therefore we see that these are some of the points which I want to discuss, that we see that some of the reasons for this Yadu dynasty disappearance and the Krishna's disappearance is that Krishna wanted to show that the Brahmana's words cannot be reversed, and he wanted to provide support for the atheistic conclusions, and he wanted to create Vairagya, to show that how the material body and material world is temporary. And Krishna, while appearing in this world, he actually, although he is beyond the laws of the material world, but he is teaching to the people by showing his personal example, that how he also, by putting himself within the laws of this world. Normally, in the case of any person, he leaves behind a particular body and then his body is burnt after the death. So Krishna also puts himself within the laws of the world. That means how the world is temporary, but although he is beyond the material world. So in order to actually show the temporary nature of the material world. So when somebody who is extraordinary, but when he actually acts within the laws of the world, and that actually creates inspiration for the common people to follow the laws. That is why Krishna says that name parthasti kartavyam trishilokeshu kinchana nana vaptam avaptavyam varta evacha karmani. That although actually I don't have any duties to perform in the entire three worlds, but still I perform these duties in order to actually show example for the common people. So I'll stop here. Prantana Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai, Srila Prabhupada ki jai.